Hey everyone, it's Joseph from MuseResources.com, and it has been a while. It's been a very long while since I've recorded an off-the-cuff tutorial of any kind, so please bear with me. I'm a little rusty. But today, I've got a tutorial on how to create an icon button that turns into a back arrow in an animated fashion when you mouse over it. It's pretty cool, it's easy to do, it just requires a little bit of setup in an image editor. It doesn't have to be Photoshop, I'm gonna use Photoshop. So here I've got a canvas with two icons on it. I've got our hamburger logo icon, and that's going to end up in Adobe Muse placed within this box. And this box in Adobe Muse, I have sized to 54 by 54. You can see on my transform panel, it shows 54 by 54. But because this site is for Retina displays, it's high DPI, we're gonna have to double that. So if we go back over to Photoshop, and we open up my image size, just so you guys can see, just for reference. My image size is 108 by 108. So it is essentially just that same 54 by 54 pixel square, but doubled horizontally and vertically because it's for Retina displays. So this is optional. But if you know that you're creating for high DPI, then just make sure that when you're at this Photoshop step, that you double the numbers. All right, so ready to get started. Let me cancel this. And we've, again, got the hamburger icon and the back arrow icon that we're going to animate between. So what's actually gonna happen here is we're gonna create one tall image, and then we're gonna have that tall image move up and down. So we've gotta get the arrow in the same relative position, but in the lower half of the canvas, meaning we have to make the canvas twice as tall. So the first thing that I would recommend doing is if you do have a background layer behind your two icons, hold Option and double click on it. Alt if you're on a PC, hold Alt and double click it. That'll turn it into just a regular layer instead of being a background layer. And that's gonna be helpful in just a moment when we have to center the back arrow in the lower half, because we're gonna, right now you can see that the burger is centered and I can hit Command A and use our centering tools on the toolbar to be absolutely sure it's centered. But once we make this canvas taller and we have the arrow on the bottom and the hamburger on top, we can't just vertically center it. It's not that simple. The burger has to be vertically centered in the top half, and the arrow has to be vertically centered in the bottom half, which is where this little tile is going to come in handy. That's why we made it no longer a background layer. So now let's duplicate, or double rather, the height of our canvas by going to Image, Canvas Size, and then in Canvas Size, this depends on whether or not Relative is checked. But we do want to go from pixels to percent. And if you have relative checked, then we're increasing the height by 100%. If you don't have relative checked, then we are increasing the height from 100 to 200. So it's important to know whether or not you have relative checked. I recommend you check it and just type 100%. We're going to make it 100% taller than it is now. And it's also important that we anchor to the top, so that way the burger stays at the top and doesn't just jump to the middle of our new taller canvas. So everything that's at the top is gonna remain at the top, and it's going to add 100% of the height downward toward the bottom. So we'll click OK. And there we go. So we've got our hamburger on top, but we also still have our arrow on top. Here's where it gets a little weird, and this is a tip. This isn't a must, but it's a tip. I'm gonna select our layer zero tile, that black tile, the black rectangle or square, which I'm referring to as a tile. I'm also gonna hold Command, which is Control on the PC, and select the back arrow. And I'm gonna drag these down together. Now, by selecting both and dragging them down together, I can see where the tile reaches the bottom. And that means when they reach the bottom together, that the arrow is centered in the lower half, that new half that we created at the bottom of this larger canvas. So we're looking all good here. Now the next thing we need to do is export this whole thing as a PNG. So one easy way to do that, this isn't necessarily the fastest way to do it in this situation, but it's good to make a habit of this if you're using Photoshop to prepare graphics. I need to group both of these together, so I'm gonna hit Command G. It would be Control G on a PC to group them together. And now I can just export this group as a PNG. The problem with that is if I export this group as a PNG, it's going to trim the pixels around just the live area, meaning it's gonna get rid of the transparent, like the extra transparent stuff around here. And in trimming that fat, it's actually gonna mess us up in Adobe Muse. We actually wanna keep all the extra pixels around the hamburger and the arrow. So the simple way to do that is just to add a mask and leave it alone. When you add a mask to a group or a layer in Photoshop before exporting that group or layer, it respects the mask as being the desired layer bounds for your export. So now the entire canvas is going to export and it's not going to trim off the extra pixels around the sides. So now we're good to go. I'm going to name this, Full Burger Arrow. And then I'm going to give it a right click and I can choose Quick Export as PNG. And that's going to allow me to put it where I want it. I've actually already done this, and I forgot what I called it originally, but I called it logo and arrow. But I've already done this, so I'm going to cancel because I've already got my PNG sitting in a folder here, and here is what it looks like. So you can't see the layer bounds, but you can kind of tell that there's this extra space at the bottom and at the top, and it's because we added that mask that we were able to do that. We were able to get that extra space, because that space is going to be what centers these icons properly when we put them in this box in Adobe Muse. So now we are ready to do just that. So with this box selected, I'm not going to drop it in as an image. I'm actually going to create an image fill by going to fill for this rectangle and choosing add image. And now it asks me what image I'm trying to add. If you're on a Mac, you can do a little trick if you've already got the folder open in the Finder. This can sometimes get a little finicky because the box to choose your file can disappear. But just a handy little tip, if you guys are using a Mac, this little icon at the top of the Finder window is actually draggable. If you click and hold for a moment, you can drag it over into a dialog box in another application and it will automatically navigate to that folder. I didn't actually move it. I just told the Finder to open this folder within the dialog that had opened in Adobe Muse. Nifty little shortcut, so you don't have to go navigate for something if you already have it open in a Finder window. So now I'm ready to select my logo and arrow PNG and open it. And it immediately centers up for me. It may not immediately center up for you. It is because under the fill settings that I have the position set to top center. So if you don't have it set to top center, make sure the position is set to top center because the burger is in the top center. The logo is in the top center of that PNG that we just loaded in. The other thing is the fitting at original size. I have it at original size because in Photoshop, I sized this properly. I sized it appropriately, and it is because of that that I get to use original size. If you had some wacky arbitrary size set in your Photoshop canvas and spit out a PNG that was too big or too small, then original size will be too big or too small. So I highly recommend getting your pixel dimensions correct so that they match between Photoshop and Muse. So that way you can use original size and you'll have no surprises. The other thing is the color should be set to transparent, which is the white box with the red slash through it. That means transparent. So we are all good here. We've got a solid fill, 100% opacity, transparent color, and we've got our image placed at original size anchored to the top so that the hamburger shows up. So now here's where it gets fun. Now we want to go over to where it says rectangle normal, which is the current state. And state means as opposed to rollover, mouse down, or active. And it's looking like it's remembering my state as I had it set previously, so I'll click that little trash can and get rid of it. But yours should show the same thing for normal, rollover, mouse down, and active. Now, the one that we're going to change is the rollover state. So when the mouse rolls over the icon, it changes to the back arrow. And the way we're going to have it do that is just by clicking on rollover, make sure you switch to rollover, and then click back on fill. And now instead of the position being anchored to the top center, we're going to anchor it to the bottom center because that's what'll make the arrow appear because the arrow is in the bottom center of the PNG that we're filling the box with right now. So now that we've gotten that anchor set, we've created a really harsh, nasty rollover, which is going to make the hamburger instantly switch to the arrow, and I can go into the browser here. I'll do Shift Command E so we can see what that looks like. And when we mouse over it, oh, nope, the transition is there. Unfortunately, I did this earlier, so Adobe Muse remembered what I did earlier. So I'm gonna go back to the normal state and show you how I added that transition because, well, it's already there. So that ship has sailed. But where that comes from is when you have any one of these states selected, you can go to transition at the bottom and you can turn on fade. What's interesting is fade doesn't necessarily mean fade, and that is the key here. Fade basically just means transition. In my opinion, there should just be a checkbox next to transition, because what it'll do is figure out how to animate the difference between the normal state and the rollover state. And you'll notice I have the normal state selected right now as I go in to turn on the fade, or turn on the transition rather. And in doing so with normal selected, it applies it to all of them. So if you do it on rollover, then you have to go back and do it on normal so that it goes back and forth, et cetera, et cetera. So if you just do it on normal, if normal is selected when you set your settings here, it applies it to all of them. So it lets you do it once instead of having to do it several times. So I've got the fade turned on, so it's going to animate the transmission. It's going to animate the transition. And I don't want a delay. I want the transition to take place immediately. And the duration, 0.2 or 200 milliseconds, is a good quick pace for a transition. This is subjective. You can set this to whatever you want. If you create a slow transition, it'll make your website feel slow. So I recommend 0.3, 300 milliseconds, or faster, meaning a lower number. So that will do the trick there at 0.2. So again, we'll open it up, we'll take a look at what this looks like, and when we mouse over it, it transitions. When we mouse out, it transitions again. So again, each one of these states has its own transition settings, but you'll notice that it says fade at 0.2 for all of these, and that's because I set it with normal selected. Do it with normal selected, it applies it to all of them. If you did it with rollover selected, it would only apply to rollover, and then you'd have to go back and do it for normal. So at the very least, it would transition back and forth and not just be a one-way transition. So that's it. That is essentially it. If you guys like this tutorial, please subscribe if you haven't already. Head over to MuseResources.com and download a bunch of free widgets and stuff, and I'll keep this stuff coming.